Dynamic programming is a really powerful algorithm. And yes, let's just get it out of the way. It is valuable to know going into a technical interview at a tech company, but its value goes well beyond that. I've personally seen and used it to solve problems around energy distribution systems, transport and logistics, and finance. And so, in around 10 minutes, I want to analyze a realistic problem with you via dynamic programming. You should be able to learn the principles to set up a dynamic programming solution to problems and know how and when it may make sense to use this algorithm. So let's not waste any more time and let's jump right into today's problem. Suppose that you are going to leave on a trip from one city and you would like to arrive at your final destination as quickly as possible. I'm going to refer to locations along this trip via these small nodes or small circles. Now, there are many different ways to go from your starting point to endpoint. From your starting point, you can go to any one of four locations. And from those four locations, you can go to another one of four locations, and so on until you finally reach your final destination. Now, you want to figure out the fastest route possible, and you can already see that there are a lot of available paths. How many possible paths, you might ask? Well, let's quickly count them up. And as you'll notice, there are 256 possible combinations, which means that we may need to do a lot of calculations. And as you might imagine, this is actually a fairly small problem. Perhaps think back to one of your more recent trips to work, school, or a gathering with friends. You very likely had many more choices in terms of the streets and paths that you could take to get to your final destination. So, is there a way to solve this problem without having to visit every path, which will be really valuable for larger problems? Definitely. And I'll show you how via an algorithm known as dynamic programming. Now, before I introduce dynamic programming and solve this problem, let's try and understand the general context when dynamic programming is useful. First, we frequently apply dynamic programming when we can break down a decision-making process into stages. For our problem, we have six stages. The initial stage is our starting city, the last stage is our arrival location, and in between there are four points where we need to make a decision around what to do next. Now, for a given stage, we could be in just one location, as is the case for our first and last stage, or we could be in one of multiple locations. We will refer to these locations as quote-unquote states, which in dynamic programming refers to the information needed at a stage to make an informed choice. So to know where to go next, I probably need to know where I was, and so we need to define these in setting up a dynamic program. Finally, for each state, we need to define our available actions in setting up a dynamic program. And we need to have a sense around how our choices will affect us in the next stage. In our problem, if we leave a location following a certain path, we should probably have a sense of where we will be next. So if you can define a problem in terms of stages, which are made up of states and actions, dynamic programming is a really good starting point to think about analyzing a problem. So let's solve this problem through dynamic programming, and here is the basis of the way I'll go about solving it. And note here, bear with me for the next 2 minutes. As when we actually solve our problem, things will become far more clear. We know that the optimal decision at a given stage is independent of past stages. To know the best course of action at a given stage, we simply need to focus our attention on the future. So let's take this problem and break it down into bite-sized chunks. And these bite-sized chunks will be our stages. And I'm going to propose that we solve this problem actually going backwards, or from last to first. And as we solve each stage, let's save our results and use them for future calculations. For example, if we start at the last stage, we know that we are already at our final destination, so we are no longer traveling and we should be staying put. Now let's save that information and go back one more stage. For each state in action, we know the travel time to the next stage and what we will do once we get there. So let's save that information and again go back one more stage. And this idea of taking a large problem, breaking it down into smaller stages, and using the results of a previously calculated stage to solve the next one is the essence of dynamic programming. And we'll just repeat this process all the way back to our last calculation stage to ultimately determine the fastest route. Now that may or may have not made sense. So rather than me continuing to yap about this theory, let's solve our problem and see if it was really worth our time to implement. Let's remove all of the arcs and let's zoom in on the final node or the final stage in our diagram. I'm going to place a series of numbers above each of these nodes, which will reflect the total time to go from that node to the final destination. So if I'm already at the final node, then there is no more traveling taking place, so let's place a zero above it. And just like I explained, let's go back one stage, remembering that to arrive at my final location, we may have been coming from one of four states or locations. So let's redraw our arcs, and let's also add to our diagram the travel time to go from one node to the next. Now, for each of our four nodes at this stage, let's quickly add up two values, the travel time between nodes, as well as the recorded travel time from the node or the stage that we are arriving at. So for the top node, the travel time from this location to the final node will be 10 plus 0. A fairly trivial result, but believe me, this way of thinking through the problem will prove valuable quickly. Now let's quickly do the same thing for the other three nodes, and once I've done that, I am going to move my attention to one earlier stage. Now again, we have four possible states at this stage, but the trips generated from these nodes will not go directly to the final location. Rather, for each node, there are four locations that you can go to, and those four locations are the ones we just evaluated. So now let's just examine the top left node. Assume that you are at this location and you are trying to determine the fastest route. We can determine that quite easily by completing the same process that we did earlier. For each of the four available paths, we are going to add up again the travel time between the locations as well as the recorded travel time at the node that we are going to. So for example, if you were to follow the top path, it will take you 16 minutes to travel between the nodes, and we know that it will take an additional 10 minutes to go from the node that we will be arriving at to the final destination. So the total trip length for this particular path would be 26 minutes. Now I can do the same for the other three directions, and it looks like the top route is the fastest at a total of 26 minutes. And so let's highlight that route in green and the others in red. And let's remove the three red paths from consideration, as they are clearly slower and suboptimal, and record above this node 26 minutes, as that is the travel time associated with the optimal route. Now let's quickly complete the same process for the other nodes at this stage, and once we've done that, let's go back one more stage. And while we quickly fast forward, note that I am saving these preferred paths and their travel times, which we'll use for upcoming calculations. Now this will be the last time I work through this calculation. If we are at the top node, we again know the distance between it and the next locations. And furthermore, we have retained for the next stage, or those upcoming locations, the optimal travel time and route between them and the final destination. So for each of these four directions, let's add the travel time between the nodes and the remaining travel time together, find the route that requires the least amount of time to travel, and record its total travel time to the final location and retain its suggested path. And so hopefully you're beginning to see a pattern. In dynamic programming, we are taking a large problem and breaking it down into smaller problems of a similar structure. We are solving for each stage by leveraging the recorded values from the previously calculated stage, and we are assuming the values associated with those calculated stages are optimal. Now let's just quickly zoom through the remaining calculations, and once completed, let's zoom out and see the final result. What we now have is a diagram that tells us a couple of things. For each node, we know the fastest travel time between it and the final destination. We also know the choice that allows us to minimize our travel time, as the arcs have been retained for the optimal route. And so if we were at the starting node, we know that we can reach the final destination in just 48 minutes, and that can be achieved by following the connected path I've highlighted in green. So now that we've done this whole problem, what can we say, and what have we hopefully learned? First off, our proposed approach took a lot less steps to calculate the optimal path. How many less steps? Well, let's quickly count. 56, which is far less so than enumerating across all possible paths, as you can see below. And what is the basis of this 56? At each stage, we know the number of scenarios or states that we can be in, and the number of actions for each state. So for the second stage, there are four possible states that we can be in, and in each stage, we can travel in one of four directions. So 4x4, or 16 state action pairs. And we can also note that our number of calculations scale in an additive nature with the number of stages, which is really important. It implies that dynamic programming is particularly advantageous for problems where there are a number of stages. Now, with an understanding of the core components of dynamic programming, what are some of the challenges around its implementation? Let's consider the problem of running a logistics company. Your goal is to perhaps minimize your shipping costs for your orders received. So based on what I said earlier, you can probably define this quite easily as a dynamic program. You may need to make choices each day, and so each day could represent a stage in your decision-making process. Now, to make an informed choice of what to do next, you likely need to know the location of each vehicle in your fleet, and the current location of your orders, and the quantity received. So that would define the state of your system in each stage. And given that information, your choice or action would be to send each of your vehicles in a given direction. And so while we can clearly define our states and actions, there are clearly a lot of them. So many, in fact, it would be difficult to enumerate across all of them within just a single stage. And furthermore, there is uncertainty underlying your choices. For example, you don't necessarily know weather patterns and what they will be like in future stages. So how do you deal with this challenge? Now, based on what I just said, does this mean what we covered in this video today was useless? Absolutely not. Rather, it provides the building blocks for analytical techniques such as stochastic dynamic programming and reinforcement learning that can handle these challenges. And so this video is one of a new mini-series on this channel where I will teach and cover sequential decision-making analytics. We will cover how we can build on today's video to solve it and others using Python. We will be able to solve large-scale problems, and we will learn how we can optimize sequential choices under uncertainty. And so if you want to learn more about this content, do not hesitate to subscribe to the channel to be notified of future videos in this series. I am sincerely appreciative of your time, and I look forward to seeing you soon.